pencils.
So, I'm going to tell you about my week, first of all, because, and I want to do it, I am not crying when I tell you that, because when I tell you all the things, you're like, oh man, she's got a big part here. But I figured out how this relates to the lesson, I promise you, it will relate to the lesson. So, this week, I had an accident. And not in my car, but on foot. So I go out and most of you know that I've been walking all summer. Well, I leave my job at 71st and Lewis. I walk down 71st to Riverside, up Riverside to 81st, back 81st to Lewis and back, and then 71st two more times, 6 miles. Praise God. And well, up to 6 miles. I'll do 4 to 6 miles. 4 on a day. If I don't feel like it, I'll do at least 4. And most of the time when I get started, I feel better and I go on. Well, just as I get started on my walk, there's a little difference in the sidewalk and I trip. And of course, usually, you know, I know how to fall. I catch myself. Well, just as I'm falling, the wrist goes out.
Oh, my goodness.
So I slide across the sidewalk and I get up. My knees are bloody. My lip is bloody. I taste blood in my mouth. My elbows are scarred. And not only that, I didn't even realize the whole depth of it until later on in the week. I looked and I thought, how did I do my whole face? So I go back to work and I get all cleaned up, of course. Sister Deborah, you know how HR is.
Yes.
They got to go through all the reports there. Now, I used to work HR, so I understand. I get it. So we get all cleaned up, and then, of course, they're concerned. Well, maybe you should just sit here, you know, or call your husband, come get you home. I said, no, I'm going for a walk. And, of course, that kind of got deal, but my thinking is if I got to carry the scars, I got to at least be able to say I won. So I go out and I do my walk, but in wisdom and not to seem like I'm using my righteousness as a cloak of maliciousness. You know, the people were genuinely concerned and all. I don't want to do that. I said, I tell you what, instead of walking the route I normally do, I'll just walk around the building. And I walked around the building for an hour and a half. And I made sure that every lap I walked around that building, and I timed it, every lap was faster than the one I previously walked. Praise God. So I got the victory there. I came back and I looked in the mirror, and have you ever seen the movie Hitch? I looked like Hitch. Both lips were swollen. This side of my face was swollen and bruised. Of course, the knees. I didn't realize until later that the elbows too, and all. But I'm like, you know what, devil, you're not gonna get the victory. I made this wall for you. I won. Praise God. And not only that, but I'm standing here and I'm doing my job and I'm doing it well. I win. So go on and I've got the victory. Of course, the next day you're a little bit sore than you were the first time. And came time to walk again, and my husband says, well, I understand if you don't want to. Nope, we're going to go walk again. Now, you might think that maybe he wasn't walking in faith, or you hearing Brother William. That don't sound like him. I mean, he actually was walking in faith. He just didn't want to seem like he was unconcerned and uncaring. And I think he did it so that the devil wouldn't have the opportunity to get in my mind and say, you don't care. Praise God. So he didn't want to give the devil no room with that. Even knowing that me and the word and a person of faith that I am, he knew I was going to go walk anyway. Praise God. So we go all through the week there, and it was pretty, you know, being pretty sore. Make it through the week, it was tough. So I almost decided, my husband, he was on a business trip, and I almost decided that I'd just go on a business trip with him and just take the opportunity to stay in the hotel and rest. But I look forward to these trips when he's gone because I can get some stuff done. I haven't said that. Now, Brother Williams is pretty good at cleaning up behind himself, and as a matter of fact, he works out of the house, so just because he's there more than I am, he probably does more of the housework than I do these days there, because he can't stand to see it not done. Praise God. And I like that. I love that about him, but he's just not as detailed as I am. So I'm going to take the time to do the things that I need to do. Well, I get in my car after he leaves to get ready to come home, and the car just won't do it. And the car has done this before, just for me. Can't get it to do it for him, couldn't get it to do it for me again. Just takes forever to start. I make it through the week. So finally yesterday, I said, you know what? I'm going to take this car, I'm going to park it, and I'm just going to leave it there. And not even realizing that in my mind, I hadn't even equated it to giving up, because I'd already told myself that I'm going to rest this weekend. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I'm not giving up. Well, my husband, and plus, you know, it was a good thing I was going to go home and stay anyway, because I had planned to do those things and get them all caught up. Mm-hmm. Well, my husband called me in the middle of the night last night and says, I forgot to get somebody to teach my Sunday school class. He called Brother Travis. You can't call Brother Travis. I don't want to call Brother Travis this time of night and tell him to prepare for the lesson. He don't even have the books. I got him. You know, I don't want to give him last-minute notice. Now, mind you, I've got last-minute notice, but that's okay, because mm-hmm. I just, being married to Brother Williams for 35 years, that just comes with the territory. I understand that. Praise God. And the benefits of the package is, you know, it outweighs the disadvantages. So I'm okay with that. And even if I wasn't, love covers a multitude of faults, but I didn't even have to cover that one. I didn't even go there. I didn't get bent out of shape. I'll get up in the morning and I'll study the Sunday school lesson. Mm-hmm. So I got up and I got the lesson, and I was blessed because it's talking about the thing that I probably talk about the most, the importance of the Word of God. Mm-hmm. For example, I don't think you all have ever heard me speak that I didn't tell you the importance of studying the Scriptures. To get the word in your heart, yeah. And things like that. So I'm cool with that. So I thought, well, I might have to call somebody to get a ride to church. So I get up at 7:30 and I go start up the car. Does fine. Go back, get ready. Got ready to leave this morning. Car won't start. So I almost called Brother Travis again. I said, I didn't want to give him last minute notice, but this is really last minute notice. I'm calling him. He's already at church now, because this is probably on your way to on your way here already anyway. So I just kept messing with it, go back every once in a while, and finally started. I'm here. Praise God. Praise God. Glory to God. You think that's it? Okay. I couldn't tell you where the start was. No, I ain't gonna go fix it either. So, when Brother Williams come, I'm gonna say go fix it. And when the mechanic say he can't find him, keep it till you do. Praise God.
Just put battery water some of the distilled battery water in it. From time that that'll go too. It'll mean the water can move from the battery.
I'm kind of like my mother, and Daniel always teases. It talks about my mother, because my mother just likes things in order and right, and she likes things to do when they happen. And so she had a car that she probably had. It was a nice car. Never had any trouble. Stopped on it one time, okay. Stopped on the second time. I got to give you a new car. So, I said, okay, now, this car has got to do what it's got to do, so the mechanic can keep it until it fixes it. I don't want a new car payment, so. So you just got to fix it. I just got to have faith to get a new car without a payment. All right, so today's lesson, and we are starting in the second lesson of the book, so we're going to be doing a little bit of catch-up, a little bit, and a lot of the reference scriptures and referencing back to what the scriptures said last week anyway. We're talking about Solomon. And it's in Proverbs, the fourth chapter. If you don't have, I guess I need to look, because I brought new ones this time. So we're going to start with Proverbs 4:10. And Solomon is talking to his son, trying to just impound on him the importance of the word here. Praise God. And somebody read that 4:10. We'll just jump right into it since I took so much time telling my testimony here. I'll tell you how it ties in just a minute.
Hear, O my son, and receive my saying, and the years of thy life should be many.
Praise God.
Did you just want 10?
We'll go ahead and do 10 and 11.
Okay. I have taught thee in thy way of wisdom. I have led thee in right paths.
So Solomon is telling his son here, and if you listen to, read the earlier chapters of Proverbs, he's exhorting his son to follow in the way, to follow God's commandments, to do the things that will make, and telling him the things that need to be done to make his life successful. Praise God. And sometimes, you know, we hear our parents tell us things. And how many of us, and I don't know, I'm not even going to look because I know probably we all near time roll your eyes. Sometimes even more. I wasn't a mouthy child, so I was one of those quiet dissenters. Praise God. But I always wonder why in the world do they have to go through that? So why do I have to hear this lecture over and over and over again? You told me that last week and the week before and the week before that. Why do I have to go through all that? And not only that, we think that our lives, what we're going through, is the first time anybody has ever gone through it as children. Things were so different when you were little. You don't understand anyway, Mama. Praise God. This is not even relevant to my life. But not knowing, you know, and sometimes the kids, when they say that, they do have a point. Things are totally different now. And, you know, the way it is there. But if they have godly parents, and all of our children do, you realize that the Word of God never changes. And so it is relevant, whether they realize it or understand it or not. So Solomon is exhorting his son here. Praise God. He follows to it to follow in the ways of the path. It means to keep on course there, to just follow after it and all. And Solomon expressed confidence in his parental instruction, and I'm just reading the lesson exposition here out of to speed it up. His teaching wasn't just merely the theoretical, since he spoke the way of the past. It indicates an approach to living. The way of wisdom implies not just the way to find wisdom, but the life wisdom prescribes. It is the way wise people live. And then he tells him how important it is. The picture of life as a pathway is now expanded. When thou goest, thy steps shall not be straightened. And straightened is an old word that means narrowed or impeded. Mm-hmm. And it is the wicked fool who follows all of these different paths and all. And so not only do you have to stay in the word or follow the path, but you also have to not follow the path of the wicked. And so he's giving his son this exhortation. And he even continued in verse 12, someone read that one for me, and 13.
When thou goest, thy steps shall not be straightened, and when thou runnest, thou shalt not stumble. Take fast hold of instruction, let her not go, keep her, for she is your life.
In other words, it says that you can even run and not stumble, like I did. Praise God. And I hadn't even got to the running part yet there, praise God. But if you continue in the Word, if you do the importance of the Word, if you just take that and you adhere to the commandments and you study and you obtain it, you go after it, then even when you're running, you're not going to stumble. Praise God. You know, and running doesn't necessarily tended to be, you know, walking fast, but it just means experiencing all the things that you got to experience in life. Praise God. You know, it would be nice that if we got to be Christians that life would just be all rosy and everything, butterflies and daisies or whatever, you know, but it doesn't. Life still happens. And the things that happen in life are not always pleasant, but we can experience those and be victorious, and not only can we be victorious, but we don't get stumbled up over or trapped over, and we don't get all messed up over. Praise God. We can just go through it and experience it and experience it in victory. Praise God. Only if you attend to the Word. Then it tells us to take fast hold to instruction. Don't let it go. In other words, you've just got to tenaciously grip the word is what the opposite is there. It means that you've got to not only get the word, it's just not just enough to get the word, but you got to continually go after it. You have to attend to it so you don't forget it. You know, you always wonder, you know, especially those of us that have been saved for years and years and years, you hear testimonies of somebody who's been saved and you wonder. After all we have been through, and you know, it's people that you've been through and you've experienced and victories and faith with and ups and downs of lives and all, and they seem to be really on the road and doing it, and all of a sudden you hear about they backslidden. And you wonder, how in the world can that be? But it's just not enough just to get the word. You got to keep getting the word. Keep going after it. Praise God. And that is what he's telling them here in verse 13 and 14. Or 12 and 13. Let's do 14 and 15, somebody.
Enter not into the path of the wicked, and go not in the way of evil men. Avoid it, pass not by it, turn from it, and pass away.
The author of this suggests that maybe he was talking to his son, a son that had already been enticed by evil. And there's a good chance that probably was there, because you know, if he's a young man in the right age there where he needs to be having this talk, he probably has been enticed. And as a matter of fact, his father's telling him, he understands he's going to be enticed there, so just don't go that way. Because not only do you stay away or not do evil, but you need to stay away from evil. And it even tells them to not only take it, but when you get to it, turn and go the other way. Okay, just go looking on, you know, saying, I got the victory, I'm saved, I got the victory, yeah, devil, you have no dominion over me, and stand there and sit and gawk at it. I remember when I first got saved, there was some people that got saved with us, and, you know, they got in their mind that, you know, we were evangelists in church, and we go out into the world and do it. Well, they got in their mind that they're going to go to the bars and witness, you know, and said, well, you know, but, you know, we can't run from it, and yet, no, you're not supposed to run to it. We are supposed to take the word to the world, mm-hmm. but there's a way to do it without putting yourself in a position of they just going, and at first they seem to be doing just fine, but not a single one of them is saved right now, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. or walking. Every one of them is backslidden right now. You know, later on, and I didn't have time, you know, at the last minute notice to look, but in Proverbs, when Bathsheba is talking to her son, she's telling him to stay out the red light district. Or stay away from married women. Mm-hmm. And he talks about the evil woman and says, hey, she'll be on the corner hollering, hey, my husband's gone. Come here. And she tells him, she warns him sternly, stay away from that or you'll die. And that's the way it is when we get too close to evil, it yes. calls our name. You know, you hear some people sometimes, their excuse was, it was calling my name. And they probably were right. You know you're not supposed to eat that, but that cheesecake was calling my name. Praise God. I know I'm not supposed to go there, but it was calling my name. And that's what happens when you get too close to evil. It just calls your name. Because in Jeremiah it says the heart is desperately wicked. Mm-hmm. And Satan knows that. Yeah. And he's hoping that you don't know who you are so that he can get that desperately wicked heart to go on and do it. Because the only difference between the heart that is desperately wicked and the person who's walking in victory's heart is that the person who is walking in victory, as David says, thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. Having the word keeps your heart. As a matter of fact, the word also says that he works in us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. So as a saved person, evil is present, but we've also got the word working in us if we attend to it. The problem is sometimes when the Holy Spirit talks to us, we don't, you know, it might be warning us not to do that, but if you don't know the language, I mean, you can speak to me in Arabic all you want. You can holler, don't go, and I'm going to go. Because I don't know what you're saying. I don't understand the language. Because I haven't taken the time to study everything. And that's the way it is sometimes with people, you know, you said the word is in English, but it's not in our minds. We don't discern it with our minds. It's our spirits that discern it. And so even though in our mind we understand the English, if it's not in our spirit, when the Holy Spirit is talking to our spirit, we don't recognize the words. Praise God.
Amen.
Let's see, where did we start off? 15? We're going to skip, do a quantum leap to verse 20. It's wisdom as a source of help. We need Brother Williams here to teach this one. Y'all hear his testimony again. He never gets sick. Praise God. And he doesn't. And even if the enemy tries to attack his body, he will not accept it. Praise God. You know, and I think I'm learning from him, because when I fell down, that was a good opportunity to say, today is the day for exercise. But I just would not accept. And then, because the word was in me, I said, Satan, you are a liar. Yes. I am more than a conqueror through Jesus that loves me. And I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. So with my sore knees and my swollen face, I walked an hour and a half. Now, because I wasn't walking on the path that I walk, I can't tell you that I walked 6 miles, because I know at first I started off pretty slow, but every lap was faster than the one before. Mm-hmm. I make sure of that. Praise God. Now, let's go ahead and read verse 20 and 21.
My son, attend to my word, incline thine ear unto my saying. Let them not depart from thine eyes. Keep them in the midst of thine heart.
Praise God. Just what I was saying, you have to incline your ear. And inclining indicates that you're just leaning your ear toward the word. Mm-hmm. It means be anxious to listen to it. Be anxious to find it. You know, somewhere in the scriptures it says the principal thing, I believe it was in Proverbs 3. Let's see if we can find that. His wisdom.
Benefits of wisdom.
Let's see. If I can find it.
What were you looking for?
Where it says that wisdom is the principal thing, or the main thing. If you find it, just let me know, buddy. Oh.
Is it 13, happy is a man that finds wisdom?
Oh, it's in this verse, verse 4, or chapter 4, verse 7.
7.
As a matter of fact, let's start with verse 5. Get wisdom, get understanding, forget it not, neither decline for the words of my mouth. Forsake her not, talking about wisdom, she shall preserve thee, love her, and she shall keep thee. Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom with all thy getting, and with all thy getting, get an understanding. So not only do you go after wisdom, and wisdom, we can say the word, we can interchange that with the word. Mm-hmm. Not only are you going to go after the word, you need to study the word, because it says, with all you're getting, get an understanding. It says that study, I believe it says in Timothy, where it says, study to show thyself approved as a God, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You're not going to understand it unless you go after it, unless you study it, unless you meditate on it, unless you take the time to go out and get the understanding. Praise God. Let's see, verse 23. Oh, we still have that. Let's 22. Yeah. I don't think we did.
For they are life unto those that find them, and health to all their flesh. Mm-hmm. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life.
Still speaking of the Father's word, Solomon wrote, for they are life unto those that find them, and health to all their flesh. We're reminded that godly wisdom provides fullness of life that God intended for us. Those who find it, it becomes health to their flesh. So not only, you know, in the natural, you have different remedies for the mind, the body, and the spirit. But if you take care of the spirit by doing the word, the rest of it is going to come along. Praise God. It's going to bring that health. The word says he sent his word and it healed them. And we know that God never changes. Praise God. And so in getting the word and getting that wisdom, we also get the benefit of health. Praise God. Let's look at 1 Timothy 4:8 as a reference scripture. Read verse 6, and in this, Paul is giving Timothy instruction for godly living, and also instructions to be a minister. In verse 6, he said, if you put the brethren in remembrance of these things, and the things that he was talking about earlier was the commandments and all, and you know what the word said, then you will be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished up in the words of faith. And we understand that faith comes by the word. So when you're attending into the word, the faith is coming. So you're nourished up in the words of faith and of good doctrine, whereunto thou hast attained. In verse 8 it says, bodily exercise profited little, but godliness is profitable to all things, having the promise of life that it now is, and that which is to come. And so it's saying, you know, this bodily exercise, my going out and exercising, it's a good thing. But remember we said the main thing or the principal thing is wisdom or the word. Praise God. Mm-hmm. Let's do verse 23, and I think that's the last one, isn't it?
It goes to 27.
No, let's pick up 27, okay? Mm-hmm. In verse 23, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Now, why are you supposed to tell us to keep our heart? Praise God.
It's where the word is.
Because that's where the word is. But not only that, I think I referred to the scripture earlier in Jeremiah. It said that the heart is desperately wicked. Mm-hmm. Praise God. And so if you don't apply the word to it, it, by nature, it's wicked. And so you wonder how people stumble around and they backslide and they go on when they get away from the word. Well, the heart of man without the word is wicked. You're doomed to fail without the word. You know, you could listen to the preacher a little bit and get a little bit of faith here and there. But you know that faith has to come from inside sometimes to do it. I remember, and as a matter of fact, the Lord has been dealing with me on that, and I'm going to talk about that one of these days. We had a lesson where we were talking about Samson. And Donnell asked the question is, you know, Samson was dedicated as a baby to serve the Lord, and he was always told that you're going to do this and do that and do this and all. And he made the question was, well, was he doing it because he was told to do it, or was he doing it because it was an inward thing that he didn't need to do it? And we decided that that was part of his problem, is that it was not coming from the inside. That faith was fed into him from the outside. You know, I'm gonna preach this one today, I promise. I teach it. It got me to thinking about, you know, history. You know, man is, it's been pretty inventive. And he's just wired to do things and get things accomplished. He was created in the image of Creator. Mm-hmm. So he's wired, it's in him to do things. And all the time, he's always inventing things to try to get it easier. First, it was the invention of the wheel. And man did pretty good with the invention of the wheel and plowing, pulling that, having the animal pull that cart and all. He got things done and things done. But the world really didn't start progressing until the industrial age. Mm-hmm. That was the Industrial Revolution. And the invention of the engine. Mm-hmm. Well, the very first engine were steam engines. They were external combustion engines, where the power came from the outside, and I don't know cars, but it must be the Holy Spirit, because that's where it came from. Well, it did an okay job. It got them going, but it wasn't going as fast as men wanted to go. When they figured out how to make an internal combustion engine, and they start bragging about 0 to 60 in something point seconds. Praise God. But coming from the inside, it gave them so much more power. And that's the way it is when we're saved. We do pretty good because we have some excellent teachers around here. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can't sit under Pastor Hill and not get something that's going to be beneficial to your life. Right. And you'll run along, you'll be okay. Mm-hmm. But the real power to really overcome those extra trying days, or those extra hard circumstances, has to come from the inside. And it has to come out of your heart. And the only way that you're going to get faith in your heart is you're going to have to put words in your mouth. I think Pastor Hill says that the mouth feeds the heart, faith when you don't need it, and the heart feeds the mouth faith when you do need it. Is it something like that? Mm-hmm. Something like that. I know I didn't see it the way he did. He so eloquent in words and all. But that's the way it is, because it's coming in the heart. And so that's why it's so important to guard the heart and to get the word in the heart. As David said, "Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee." And you know, as I meditate on that scripture, and that's one of my favorite scriptures, it just always is just, I realized one day I just hit that aha moment. I put the word in so that I don't walk in doubt. Because the Bible says, whatsoever is not of faith is sin. And without faith, it's impossible to please God. Praise God. So the word is hidden there so that you can walk pleasing God. That you can have victory over sin. Praise God. All right, so much on that. I can talk all day. You know, I tell y'all, this is my favorite subject, is the importance of the word. Verses 24 to 27. And how's my time?
You got 10 minutes.
Oh, cool. I was worried with me being late and then going through the long testimony that we might do, and that's why I was kind of rushing through that, but we're going to make it. And we'll be sitting in our spots when it's time.
But you're on 24. Mm-hmm. Put away from thee a froward mouth and perverse lips. Put far from thee. Let thine eyes look right on, and let thine eyelids look straight before thee. Ponder the path of thy feet, and let all thy ways be established. Turn not to the right hand, nor to the left. Remove thy foot from evil.
Praise God. This is telling us not only what we are to say. You know, the word tells us, you know, that we should avoid profane language and all. But the word also tells us what that we should put in our mouth as well. I was thinking of the scripture just as it said that, let no vain or profane thing come out of your mouth.
Yes.
That is... And you all have to forgive me if I have known this. Would have been written down already.
What was one of those you skipped?
Let's see, maybe profane will do it. But it tells us in that same scripture, it may be in Ephesians. But just in case we don't find it, it tells us not only to not let that come out of your mouth, but what should come out of your mouth is what is going to be edifying. Mm-hmm. Praise God. Danielle, and I think every year when we get to this and in the studies and all, we always, this scripture always comes to my attention and remembrance, because when my son was about 5 or 6 years old, you know, we have family members, and quite a few of them were not saved. And you know how sometimes when you get saved, people will try to justify mm-hmm. what they do and tell you why it's okay. So, and they always made a point of doing that when they were in our presence. Well, my children were there, not with me there and all, but they felt the need, and it was just the witness of the Holy Ghost, I guess, to explain to them. Well, actually, I know why it came up. They started cursing. Mm-hmm. So my son tells them, Grandma or Granny, the Bible says, let no vain or profane thing come out of your mouth. Now, this is a six-year-old, praise God. And boy, did that stir up some stuff. So they went on to tell him how our church thinks that we know what's going on. Actually, it was before he told them that. They shouldn't be cursing. And, well, your church think your way is the only way to do that. And he said, well, it's not the church. The Bible says. And I had absolutely no idea what was going on. But later on that night, Daniel gets a call. And I mean, they're ranting and raving, telling us that we need to teach our son not to do that, because somebody's going to hurt him. And they were saying, well, no, we love him, we wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
But, I mean, they were just really, really bent out of shape. But what came out of that, now, they were too proud to go to our church, but they started going all over the place looking, trying to find things. And you know, it's sometimes because you're sometimes going the wrong place first, but they are slowly gravitating there. But that started, the wheels are moving. That was just the Holy Spirit doing that. Mm-hmm. Praise God. And, you know, it just amazed me that came out of the mouth of a baby. Mm-hmm. Praise God, they got that going. But, you know, that was coming out of his mouth. He said, well, this is just what the word says. And he didn't realize it at the time, but what he was telling them was edifying. Mm-hmm. It was building them up. It pointed them in the direction that they should go. Praise God. And that's the way our thing, if we are now, children's hearts, you know, sometimes they have not been corrupted by all of the things that are going around in the world yet, and heaven, faith hasn't been torn down. And so they can sometimes see it just right off, you know. And so, and for us, because we have had all of those experiences and things that go against faith, as Daniel said last week, there's lots of voices in the world. Yeah. And I think I once read that for every positive thing you hear, you have 17 negatives. Mm-hmm. So the chances of you picking up on the negative are really good, unless you make that extra exerted effort to go towards. It says incline your ear to wisdom. You got to lean towards the wisdom. You got to press to do that, because I don't know anybody other than my husband that just gets saved and just a little love, just can't wait to get to the word. Mm-hmm. Praise God. Most people, I'm sure somebody other than my husband, but most of the people have closer, maybe not quite as bad experiences I did. I mean, I could look at it, I could read it, I even tried doing other translations. It's still like, how did you get that out of that? Because I was trying to understand it with my mind. Mm-hmm. Praise God. But I didn't realize that at the time. And so, if I had not gotten in a place where Pastor Hill just continually tells you the importance of it all, I may have just decided it can't be done. And I probably would not be walking, well, I'm sure I would not be walking in faith now. Or not in complete faith. I'd be like that external, but I might still be saved, but I'm just kind of pushing along. That is either my husband or my son. Which one of the Daniels? And it was Daniel. See, when you asked me, did I forget to teach? Yes, sir. Okay. All right, good. All right, then, when we're just finishing up the class, I told them, and I said, that was when the phone rang, that's either Daniel, Daniel Senior or Daniel Junior, one of the Daniels. All right. Bye-bye. He says, okay, you finishing up? It's time to go to church now. Mind you, when he's teaching, I Well, I just want to thank God for the word. Thank you for your patience. And again, sorry that I was late, but you know, oh, I promise you that I tell you how that my story tied in to the word. Having the word in me already, the word came out of me when I came across this situation where it was time, it was excellent opportunity to say, I'm not going to do it. I'm going to give up. But because the word was in me, when that situation came, it just automatically came out that, hey, I'm going to say, no, I will not accept defeat. I will. And that's the way it is. It's when you got the word in you, you just won't accept defeat. Praise God. Yeah. So if you won't accept defeat, the only thing else you got to accept is the winner. Mm-hmm. Praise God. All right, then. Well, that's it. And I'll be obedient. We'll go to church now.